All right, good morning, Crossroads.
Morning.
My name is Jeff, and I'm one of the pastors here. I want to thank you for joining us as we conclude our series called The Struggle is Real. It's a series where we've been talking about how to respond to the painful emotions we can experience as a result of the struggles in life. And today we're going to talk about the emotion of anxiety. And this one hits close to home for a lot of us, as I could just tell from your reaction. Consider this, on the CDC website, I saw a study from an NHIS study that said this: from January through June of 2019, prior to COVID, 11% of adults reported symptoms of anxiety and or depressive disorders. In January of 2021, that same number had skyrocketed to 41%. For a whole bunch of us listening to this today, the struggle can be very real when it comes to anxiety. You know, some of you have heard me tell you this before, but I'm going to get really honest with you on the front end of this sermon today, that I want you to understand your senior pastor has had a significant battle with anxiety throughout my life. I can still recall like yesterday being in Mrs. Blattner's third grade class at Presentation School in North Fond du Lac, Wisconsin. Soul wrecked with irrational fears and anxiety that I couldn't even go to school. I can still recall one night my parents not realizing that I was still up, and they were sitting in the kitchen, and I could recall overhearing them talking about getting me help from a counselor because they didn't know what to do anymore. I will never forget the picture, the look on my dad's face as he sat there in that kitchen chair looking helpless because he didn't know how to help his son. I can remember getting a card from all of my third grade classmates signed by them encouraging me that it was going to be okay. I was a total mess. And while things got better, the anxiety still attacked throughout life. I was so worried about making mistakes that it was commonplace for me that all of my homework would be turned in with holes that were erased in it because I kept erasing and erasing because I needed to have everything perfect. I can recall very clearly my high school and my college years starting to wrestle with obsessive-compulsive type tendencies, switching light switches on and off 5 times because, well, that's how my mind worked, and I felt like I could never break that routine. Or having a certain routine that I would go through each night to check the locks on our family's home just to make sure that everyone was going to be safe, and feeling like I could never break that, almost wearing out the locks because of it. I can think about driving down the highway where I would hit a major bump and I would start to irrationally worry that maybe I hit somebody. And then I'd find myself having to double back just to make sure that I hadn't. And while I'm going to share later on what God did to deliver me in a major way from this, I'm standing up here today telling you that I still have to work hard to not give in to anxiety in my life. I can tell you there are still times where I go careening down that dead-end road that anxiety takes you down. But here's why I'm going to share that with you today. Because some of you listen to this, you need to know that you're not some kind of freak because you wrestle with anxiety. Anxiety is way too often this silent assassin because people are ashamed to admit that, man, I struggle. I get wrecked by worry at times. All around this building today and online, there are people who are struggling with anxiety. We know that because you've told us that over the last year. And I heard a whole bunch of people leaving First Service who confirmed that. And it's often not the people that you would think, right? It's people who look like everything's perfect. They got great jobs, great careers, great successes, relationships, everything. And yet inside, anxiety is attacking and they are hurting. And so I want you to know today, you're not alone. And I want you to know that you can defeat anxiety with God's help. I'm living proof of that. I'm telling you, there would be absolutely zero chance that I would still be in pastoral ministry 15 years later if God can't bring victory over anxiety. I mean that because pastoral ministry is way, way loaded with anxiety-producing situations. So no, the anxiety battle has never proven easy. But here's my point. When we discover that God does have a way for us to emerge victorious over anxiety, it doesn't have to stop us from experiencing God's purpose and his plan for our lives. So let me address a question that people often want to ask when it comes to this topic. Is anxiety a sin? Now, candidly, I've been much more dogmatic about this in the past that it is a sin, but I think further clarification is at least helpful. I appreciated the way Dr. Jeremy Pierre of Southern Seminary addressed the question. He's a professor over biblical counseling, and he said this. He said, if by worry we simply mean negative feelings associated with something that we value being threatened by external circumstances, then we wouldn't call that sin. And his reasoning for that is that both the Apostle Paul and Jesus himself in Scripture report having this level of distress at something valuable to them being externally threatened. For example, Luke chapter 12, verse 50, Jesus says this, but I have a baptism to undergo, and how distressed I am until it is accomplished. Now, by baptism, Jesus is referring to the death he would die on a cross for our sins, and Jesus had negative feelings caused by that external circumstance that threatened something valuable to him, his connection with the Father. And since we know that Jesus never sinned, he was perfect, it would seem to indicate there's room for a person to have those initial negative feelings when something they value is externally threatened without it being labeled as sin. Now, we're going to see the same thing in a passage that we study today regarding Jesus. A passage where Jesus experiences incredible distress, emotional anguish, and yet does not sin. However, having said that, we as humans often take our anxiety to a sinful level. When our anxiety causes us to lose confidence in God's goodness or his sovereignty, when our anxiety causes us to want to take control of the situation rather than trust God in the situation, when our anxiety creates a victim mentality in us, anxiety has undoubtedly become a sin at that point. Now, the reason I shared that description of sinful anxiety is because, number one, I know many of you are wondering about it. Number two, I share it because I want to make very clear that as we study our passage today, we're going to see Jesus experiencing the most intense mental and emotional turmoil anyone has ever faced into. And whatever you want to label what Jesus is going through, Jesus was not sinning because he was experiencing these feelings. And we can learn an awful lot from his response to them that can help us in our own lives. Open your Bibles with me, if you would, to Mark chapter 14. Mark chapter 14, if you don't have a Bible, you can follow along on the screens to my left and right, or on the outline you received, or on the Crossroads app. But if you've got your Bible, turn to Mark 14, we're going to anchor there. If you've got it, say, got it. All right, not many of you have it. All right. All right, most of today's message is courtesy of a sermon that I heard from Pastor Craig Groeschel on this topic. It spoke to my heart, and I'm praying it does to you as well. So let me set the context for what we're studying, okay? Jesus had just had his last supper with the 12 disciples. One of them, Judas, had just slipped away to go and betray him. Jesus knows the next day he's going to go to a cross to be nailed there for our sins. He's staring right into the face of rejection and agonizing death on the cross. And worst of all, he's about to experience the wrath of Almighty God for our sins upon his shoulder. And this crushing weight of what was to come caused Jesus to retreat for some prayer time to what was a very familiar place to them, the Garden of Gethsemane. Let's pick up our passage, Mark chapter 14, verses 32 to 34a. They went to a place called Gethsemane. And Jesus said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took Peter, James, and John along with him, and he began to be deeply distressed and troubled. My soul's overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death, he said to them. Remember, Jesus wasn't just fully God, he was also fully human, right? He laid aside his rights and privileges as God, and he embraced a human nature during his time on earth. So please don't read this passage and go, oh, he's God, it's not that big of a deal. No way. That does a disservice to what Jesus is going through. Jesus, God in the flesh, perfect, never sinned, was deeply troubled and distressed. so troubled and distressed mentally and emotionally that he says he's overwhelmed to the point of death. That's not a figure of speech. Jesus' anguish would have been enough to just about kill him had he not been preserved by the Father for another death that was coming his way. Luke, in his description of this event, says that Jesus' sweat was like drops of blood falling to the ground. Now listen, Luke himself was a doctor, and many scholars believe his words are literal in nature because there's a medical condition called hematidrosis that what happens is tiny capillaries in the sweat glands, they rupture, and that mixes blood with a person's sweat. And you want to know what causes that really rare medical condition? Extraordinary stress and anguish. And that's what Luke seems to be saying happened here. So why did Jesus feel like this? Well, because even though Jesus was perfectly innocent, he knew he was about to be arrested and he would suffer the most humiliating, awful, cruel death he could possibly die. But listen, it wasn't death that had Jesus in such distress and anguish. It was the kind of death he was going to die. Jesus knew he would experience the death that we as sinners deserve. Jesus would become sin for us. Holiness was about to become filthiness. The Father was about to pour out his wrath for the sins of humanity upon Christ. From all eternity, Jesus had always enjoyed perfect, unbroken fellowship with God the Father. But in just a number of hours, he would be hanging from a cross crying out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And in case you're thinking about some of those stories of martyrs who really courageously face their death really calmly, and you're wondering, well, why isn't Jesus like that here? It's because the death Jesus faced is nothing like any death any human being has ever faced in this world. We cannot even fathom what it would be like to know that the wrath of God for sins of the world would be coming our way. But understanding what Jesus was truly going through in the garden, boy, it should remind us all over again how beautiful our Savior Jesus is. Amen? So I trust you get the picture. The agony and anguish experienced at Gethsemane is beyond comprehension. And again, regardless of what you want to hold, it is, as Groeschel notes, how Jesus faces into these emotions in the garden really does act as a great blueprint for us for when we're dealing with something like anxiety in our own lives. So let me give you three things today that you can do to emerge victorious when the struggle is really real with anxiety. First of all, talk to your friends. Talk to your friends. It's interesting. Jesus clearly came to Gethsemane to get alone with the Father, yet he doesn't come alone. He took 11 disciples with them, and we're told he took his inner circle of Peter, James, and John even further along with him. And he tells them this in verse 34. He said, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch." Jesus' words here seem to indicate that it wasn't only as witnesses that he brought his buddies along that day. The Son of God was also fully human enough to ask for their support at this difficult time. And despite the fact Jesus knew these three were going to miserably fail him in that regard, he sure seems to want to feel their fellowship in his intense time of struggle. Jesus says, "Hey guys, will you just sit here with me? My soul's overwhelmed. I feel like dying. Would you just sit here and watch and pray?" Jesus' actions remind us that when the struggle's real, we've got to talk to our friends. You know, months back, a guy in our church family had reached out to me. He knew that I had wrestled with anxiety in my life, and he was really struggling with it at that point in his. And so we got together, and when we did, he said things like this. He said, "Oh man, you're probably going to think I'm crazy. Your opinion of me is going to completely be ruined after today." Things along those lines. It was not easy for him to talk to his friends about his anxiety. But as I started to share some of my struggles over the years, you could see the light bulb go off, and all of a sudden there was a sense of, oh, I'm not alone. I'm like you, and you're like me. And he got more comfortable talking about his anxiety without negatively talking about himself. And that led to us connecting a couple additional times. And while this guy would not tell you that he's got everything fixed when it comes to his anxiety, what he would tell you is he's not in as dark of a place as he was a number of months back. And after opening up and talking to his friends about it, he would tell you that he now knows he doesn't have to face this battle alone. And here's a really cool thing happened. My friendship with this guy grew significantly as a result of him opening up to me about that. Because remember, I want you to hear something, okay? We might be impressed by each other's strengths, but ultimately the way we connect is through our weakness. You know, listen, I share all of that with you because I believe one of the reasons people feel so anxious at this time in our world is because they're lacking godly, biblical, encouraging community in their life. Boy, so many people find themselves completely disconnected right now, isolated, alone, feeling like nobody is in their corner. Way back in the beginning of the Bible, we're told it's not good for a person to be disconnected and alone. We're made for community. There's power in the power of with. And one thing I tell every single person that I sit with who's wrestling with anxiety is that you absolutely must open up and talk about it. It doesn't matter how uncomfortable it might feel for you. You're worthy of taking other people's time. You cannot keep it to yourself. It's absolutely imperative that you drag those anxiety, that those anxious thoughts into the light. You're not alone and you're not crazy. But Satan wants you to believe that you're some kind of freak because you can't get it under control. He wants you to pull inward and think things like, oh man, if they really knew what I was thinking, they would think I'm crazy or nobody would ever want to be around me. Remember last week's message on guilt and shame? That's exactly what Satan wants you to feel when it comes to wrestling with anxiety. He wants you to feel ashamed. He wants you to self-isolate, thinking, well, nobody would want to be around me, because when you do that, he's able to work you over even more. Let me tell you something. This wasn't in my message, but I added it before the first service, and I heard from so many people as I left. I'm going to say it again. There are some of you in here right now or listening online, and you don't wrestle with anxiety at all, and you're about to check out right now. Don't do that. Here's my question for you. What are you doing to make sure you're a safe place for your friends to talk to you? Are you somebody that they can come to? Or are you like, well, I just can't relate to that, so, you know, I don't know. Stop worrying. If you're someone that's using that, can I just lovingly tell you, stop saying things like that. That's like telling a little kid, just try really hard to sleep. Didn't work, Mom and Dad. My challenge to you is this. Maybe your spouse struggles. Maybe your kid struggles. Maybe you've got a friend. Maybe you've got a coworker. Please, please be a safe place for someone to open up so they can start talking and dragging those thoughts into the light. If you're not, who are they talking to? Listen, your friends, they can't fix your anxiety issue, but your friends, maybe it's that pastor, your teacher, your life group leader, your coach, your spouse, your sister, your friends, whoever it might be, your school friends, those trusted people in your life, they are a part of God's plan to bring about victory. But you being courageous enough to open up and share what's going on is vital to victory. So listen, don't suffer in silence any longer. If the anxiety struggle is real for you, who's that friend that you'll commit to talk about it this week with? But as I said, your friends can't fix you. You're going to need to talk to somebody else for that. Let's see who Jesus talks to next during his time of incredible anguish and distress. Mark 14, verse 35 to 36. Going a little further, he fell to the ground and he prayed that, if possible, the hour might pass from him. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Here again, we see why Jesus' raw emotion involved no sin, because the question is not whether Jesus would submit to the Father's will or not. The question was directed at whether or not the way forward must include the cross. Jesus falls to the ground. He cries out to the Father. If there's any other way to save humanity from their sin other than the cross, hey, let's do it that way. Few things better display Jesus' humanity and remind us, listen, that he does know what it's like to be one of us. But Jesus does not seek to impose his will on the Father. He fully trusts the will of the Father if there is no other way. Which is exactly what most of us do not do when it comes to wrestling with anxiety and mental anguish in our own lives. Jesus' response here in the garden yields a second thing that we need to do to experience victory when the struggle is real with anxiety, and that's you need to talk to your Father. You need to talk to your Father. The most obvious key, right, for dealing with anxiety, you've got to be talking to your Father. Because let's face it, our friends are limited in terms of what they can do, as we're reminded of in verses 37 to 41a. Then Jesus returned to his disciples, and he found them sleeping. Simon, he said to Peter, are you asleep? Couldn't you keep watch for 1 hour? Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. Once more he went away and he prayed the same thing. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. They did not know what to say to him. Returning the third time, he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? So listen, guys, here's the thing. Here's a cool thing. The bar is really low in terms of us being able to support our friends, right? I mean, we can do better than this. I mean, three times Jesus goes away, cries out to the Father, and three times he comes back and the boys are catching some Z's. It's crazy. Which for our purposes today reminds us that human beings are pretty limited, though, in terms of what they can do. Perhaps you've been looking to friends to be the ones who fix your anxiety struggle. If so, your faith is misplaced. Only God can do that. And so talking to your Father, wholeheartedly talking to and crying out to the one who loves you, who created you, who can fix you, is absolutely non-negotiable. If you're not doing this, then frankly, you don't desire healing as much as you might think you do. I love Jesus' prayer here, but it's brutally honest, right? He's just having this heartfelt conversation with his Father. It's a reminder that God is big enough to handle whatever it is that we are wrestling with. I mean, I think it's crazy to think about, but God, he just wants us to talk to him. That's why just praying memorized prayers is not always best for you. In fact, I think sometimes we do our kids a disservice when we teach them to talk to their Father in heaven only using memorized prayers. And then sometimes the prayers we come up with, where did they come from? I mean, think about it. I can remember praying a prayer when I was a really young child. Some of you can probably relate. It went like this. Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I shall die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Who came up with that prayer? I mean, seriously, who thought, this is a fantastic idea. I want to tell a four-year-old, you might die tonight. And if you do, someone's coming to steal your soul. And you better pray it's God because someone else wants it too. I mean, who came up with that idea? Jesus doesn't toss up memorized prayer here. He cries out from the depth of his soul, and that's what God wants you to do. Peter says, cast all your cares on him because he cares for you. I promise you, God would rather have you get honest about what's really going on inside. He's big enough to handle all the stuff that's going on in there. Think about it like this. Sometimes when we're driving, that little red indicator light lights up on your dashboard. For me, if you've heard any of my sermons in the past, that's probably meaning that you're almost out of gas. And I just ignore that. But anyway, you shouldn't do that. But when that light lights up, usually that's an indicator that your car is in trouble, that you would be wise to seek assistance. Think about anxiety and worry as that little red indicator light in your life. It signifies that there is something wrong and you would be really wise to seek assistance. In other words, it's time to pray. It's time to talk to your Father. Because if it's big enough for you to worry about, It's big enough for you to pray about. Philippians 4, verse 6, Paul says, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Paul's saying, in every situation, pray. Take your anxiety to God. Be grateful that no matter how God chooses to answer your prayer, you can still trust his perfect will like Jesus did in the garden. And then God's peace will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. That's a promise, church. I mean, it sounds so elementary, and yet I cannot tell you how many times I talk with someone who's wrestling with anxiety, and I say, have you been diligently praying about it? And they're like, no. So if you're worried about not having friends and feeling like, boy, you're always left out, well, then you know what? Pray for more friends. If you're worried about your marriage, pray about your marriage. If you're worried about your children, start praying more for your children. If you're worried about your job, start praying about your job with God. If you're worried about Aaron Rodgers leaving the Green Bay Packers, call the church office because you got bigger issues. Okay, but here's the point, right? If it's on your mind, it's on God's heart. If it's big enough for you to worry about, it's big enough for you to pray about. So start seeing anxiety as that little warning light telling you that it is time to talk to your Father. So Jesus teaches us we should talk to our friends, we should talk to our Father. But there's something else Jesus talks to, and we see it back in Mark 14, verse 36. Abba, Father, he said, everything is possible for you. Take this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. Jesus did not feel like suffering on a cross for a crime he never committed. He didn't wake up feeling like being falsely accused, beaten, and tortured. He certainly didn't wake up feeling like being completely cut off from his Father. But despite Jesus' feelings that he wished the cross was not the only way to save us, he remains in perfect submission to the will of the Father as he utters those words, yet not what I will, but what you will, Father. On that night, as Jesus experienced mental torment, agony unlike anything we could understand, he shows us that when that emotional struggle is real, it's absolutely essential that you talk to your feelings. You need to talk to your feelings. Jesus was honest about what he was feeling, but he then proceeds to make sure that his feelings collide with God's truth, right? And the truth was, there was no other way to save you and me and offer us a chance to be brought into the family of God than for Jesus to get up, leave the garden, and go to the cross. That was the truth. And so Jesus talks truth to his human feelings. This is so applicable to our topic today because when you're wrecked with anxiety, there's a whole bunch of feelings you're experiencing. But the truth is that while your feelings are real, while your feelings are important, your feelings are not always true. Have you ever heard people say things like, just follow your heart? Ah, sweetie, just trust your feelings. Don't do that. That's horrible advice. I cannot tell you how many times we have seen people make devastating choices for their family and for themselves, and they justify it by saying things like, it just feels right, just felt right. What you've got to do is tell your feelings that they don't get to lead you. So when you're feeling so anxious that it's almost taking your breath away, when you wake up at 2 in the morning and your heart's racing and your mind's just all over the place, when you're going through the day and you're running all these what-if scenarios and you're just exhausted by 5 o'clock, you've got to identify what feelings are causing such angst within you. And you have got to, listen to me, you've got to introduce your feelings to your faith. You've got to talk to your feelings. So watch how this works, okay? When you start feeling like nobody, including God, loves you, you speak truth to your feelings. No, I know, God says, for God so loved me that he sent his one and only son, that whoever would believe in him shall not perish but have eternal life. When you start worrying about your finances, you remind yourself, no, God is my abundant provider, and he will provide all my needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. When you start feeling worried like you don't measure up, you're like, no, God says that I was knit together in my mother's womb, I am fearfully, I am wonderfully made. And when you start feeling like you can't face into that brutally difficult situation you're in right now, you can say, no, God's promises are that he will never leave me, he will never forsake me, and I can do all things through Christ who gives me strength. You get the point. Substitute your area of worry in there, whatever it is. I'm worried I'm not going to be good enough in sports. I'm worried that I'm not going to get good enough grades. I'm worried that I don't know every part of my future and how it's going to play out. I'm worried about my children. I feel like I'm a failure as a parent, whatever it is. Whatever it might be for you that's bringing on that crippling anxiety, whatever those feelings are, it's time to tell your feelings that they have to get in line. They don't get to lead you. It's time to make sure your feelings collide with your faith. You know, I opened today by telling you that anxiety and OCD reared their ugly heads early and often in my life. But what I would also tell you is that God has always been there to deliver me when things got really bad. At the height of my worrying problem in third grade, I wasn't a Christ follower yet, but I would constantly pray to God for his help with this. Then one night I had a dream where God just laid it on my heart. He said to me, Jeff, you don't have to do this worrying thing anymore. I've got you. I know some of you are like, man, my pastor's crazy. He actually believes that happened. You darn right I do. I absolutely do, because moving that forward from that, I was a changed kid. My worry wasn't completely gone, but it was much more under control than it had been. And you know what else? I had this deep realization that the God of the universe actually cared about the anxiety battle of a third grade kid. I also remember being 26 years old, living in South Carolina. I just recently trusted Christ to save me and be the leader of my life, and I had this crazy big belief that nothing is impossible for my God. But that doesn't mean that I didn't go through this period right then and there of all kinds of just thoughts that were obsessive compulsive kind of thoughts, awful thoughts that made me feel like just this crazy loser. And so finally one day I'd had enough. I drove home from work. I walked into the apartment that Sherry and I had. I went into the bedroom and I laid on the floor face first. I grabbed a pillow and buried my head in the pillow and just begged God to start healing me, to bring deliverance. I remember pleading with my father that I don't believe this is your desire for my life to stay stuck. I remember talking to my feelings and declaring, no, my God is a healer. There's nothing too big for him. And I remember talking to my father saying, God, I know you can deliver me. And that day, I'm telling you, God delivered me from my OCD, from my anxiety in a really, really powerful way. Do I still give in to worry? Do I still have to be on guard against it in my life? Yes and yes. But I'm telling you that what God did that day was a healing work that left me changed to this day. And now it's my heart's desire to tell other people that victory over that crippling anxiety is within reach. But I found that today's three tips are really important. Now, when I'm heading down that path towards worry, I'm really quick to talk to my friends. I'm really quick to talk to my wife or my sister or our fellow staff members, dragging those anxious thoughts into the light so that they don't gain power over me. Now I'm really diligent to constantly talk to my father about anything and everything that is bringing about any possible anxiety in my life. Instead of playing out what-if scenarios, what I end up doing is I ask God to help me turn my what-if scenarios into even-if scenarios, because my father is actually in the even-if scenarios. And I'm very intentional about talking to my feelings. I've memorized verses to make sure that I can take thoughts captive. I frequently read the Matthew 6 classic passage on worry. And that helps me to make sure that my feelings are constantly colliding with my faith. Anxiety's been a big part of my own personal faith story. And so I do know what it's like to feel like some of you feel right now. I know what it feels like when you feel like, man, it's never going to get any better. But God's brought victory in this area for me, and He can and desires to do the same in your life. And I'm pleading with you to give what we've talked about a try. Talk to your friends. Talk to your father. Talk to your feelings. Why? Well, because Jesus did it, and it worked. Look how the Garden of Gethsemane story concludes in Mark 14, verses 41 to 42. Returning the third time, he said to them, "Are you still sleeping and resting? Enough! The hour has come. Look, the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise! Let's go. Here comes my betrayer." Jesus knows the time for prayer is over. It's now time for Jesus to face the cup of suffering he would drink for us. But look what he does here. He wakes the guys up and he says, "Rise up. Let's go. It's time for me to face in to that source of my anguish." I don't want you to miss this. Watch this. Jesus staggered into the garden, struggling under the weight of that soul-crushing agony and anguish that he felt. But the picture is of Jesus as he exits the garden is different. Jesus looks and says, "Oh no, look, there's my betrayer. Get up, guys. Rise up. Let's go. I've got a purpose to fulfill and a mission to complete." And the picture of Jesus that we see moving forward is one of someone who's unshakable. He's full of faith, and he's determined to move forward. For many of you listening to this, worry and anxiety has robbed you of the life God has for you for far too long. It's causing you to settle for a shell of what your life could be, but that's not God's will for you. It's not God's will that you remain bound up, captive, and unable to move forward. Jesus didn't give his life so that you remained a captive. He laid his life down to set the captives free. And I believe God's saying to a whole bunch of you today, you're not crazy, you're not losing it, and you're not alone. So rise up. Don't run away any longer. Face into that source of your anxiety and move forward in my power. Trust me and watch what I'm able to do in your weakness. Listen, I believe if you put into practice what we've studied today, I believe today could be the day that a whole bunch of you look back and say, that was the day that God changed my life. Because that was the day he set this captive free. Amen? Amen. I'm going to go ahead and invite our music team to come on out here right now. But I want you, don't put your stuff away yet. No, we're not done yet. We're actually not even close. As they come out, I want you to listen to what I'm saying. For some of you, I want you to hear this. You cannot beat anxiety and worry apart from a relationship with Jesus. I'm going to say that really bluntly right now. You can put a Band-Aid on it, but you can't defeat it at the source. And for some of you right now, you're in a place right now where you go, I don't know that I've ever called on Christ to save me. I'm not talking about whether you're religious or whether you're a good person. I'm talking about, do you have a saving relationship with Christ where you've been born again and brought into a new life with him? If you're like, man, I don't even know what that means. Let me tell you that. The Bible says that we're all sinners. And Jesus gave his life on a cross so we could live. So we could be forgiven from our sins. So we could be set free. But knowing that doesn't save us. There's a choice you need to make. Pastor Adam talked about it earlier. You've got to decide who Jesus is going to be to you. You've got to decide if you're going to receive his forgiveness and his salvation and surrender your life to him. If you've never done that, that's the key to making that next step into facing into a battle with anxiety or worry, not in your own power, but in God's. So what I want you to do right now is I'm going to ask everybody here to bow your head. Every person in this auditorium, every person online right now, we're going to extend, go to extended time of response. If you're in here right now and you're like, that's me, I don't know that I've ever trusted Christ, but I want a relationship with him. I need him in my life. Simply tell him that. Tell him, Jesus, I know that I'm a sinner. And I know my sin separates me from you. But I believe, Jesus, you gave your life on a cross for me because you love me. And my life and my struggles matter to you. So today, I ask you to save me from my sin. I ask you to wash me clean, and I ask you to give me new life in you. I want a loving relationship with a living Savior. So please, do that work in my life today. I give you my life because you gave yours for me. And with our heads bowed and our eyes still closed, for every believer in here, maybe you came in here and you already know Christ, but you also know that worry and anxiety is ripping you up right now. Right now, I want you to get honest about whatever that looks like for you. Wherever it is you feel like you just don't measure up or things are all a mess right now, bring it before God. Name it. And invite God into that area of pain. That area of struggle. Let him know that you believe that he's God and he cares about your life and that he can deliver you. Talk to your Father right now. With our heads bowed and our eyes closed, Father God, we thank you for sending your Son to give his life for us. Jesus, we thank you that we can learn from your example how to face into things in our life. I pray today would be the day that a whole bunch of people walk forward saying, that was the day that not some sermon changed my life, but that the living God changed my life. That was the day that he did a work in my life. God, I pray that right now, God, you would set the captives free. Everyone in this building, everyone listening online, I pray that you would bring freedom. I pray that you'd help people move forward, not being bound up, not being stuck, but trusting God that you're in there tomorrow and you never leave them or forsake them. It's in your Son's beautiful name we pray. Amen. You know, listen, if today you made a decision to trust Christ for the first time, or here's what I want you to do. I want you to text the word peace, if that was your decision, to 920-717-1715. Or you can take your Connect card, write it on that, and turn it into black boxes as you leave. But we'd love to talk to you about what a relationship with Jesus looks like. Or maybe you're someone who's like, man, I want to talk to someone about what's going on in my life with worry and anxiety. Text that same word or turn it in on your card, and we'd love to connect with you about that in your life. Last thing I'll tell you is, we're going to have people up front praying underneath the screens after the service today. As we conclude this series that's been pretty powerful in a lot of lives, don't miss your chance to have someone pray for you today if you have that stirring going on, if you have that sense that, man, I just love someone to pray for me. Up front here afterwards, we'd love to have that privilege. So let's go ahead and stand right now. We're going to go to God in closing song.